One of the more annoying habits of modern minds is to imagine that modernity invented all of its own facets. There are many serious men who truly believe the notion of total war did not exist beyond our own time, or that war before the industrial age was somehow frivolous or gentlemanly. As with most such stupidities, we can attribute it to a lack of classical reading and historical reading in general. When the phrase philosophy of war is uttered, many think instinctively of von Clausewitz and his famous treatise on war, but the great flaw of that work is that it relies on the existence of a liberal national nation-state, of which Germany was arguably the prime example. Clausewitz's book is really a detail on how to direct a national effort towards one's enemies, and so we will need to go much further than that. Instead, we will look at the eternal and unchanging aspects of war, the layers of will and struggle that exist in all kinds of combat, and the spiritual, metaphysical strength that I believe is the chief deciding factor in who achieves victory and who does not. Any ruler, any nation, any army, or any single man who wishes to go to war or engage in some kind of combat is faced with a prerequisite. For what reason will he take another life? For what reason will he risk his own? When a man has a solid metaphysical foundation in place, he can tell himself, without any great doubt, the answer to these questions. At its core, the metaphysics of war and death need to tell a warrior what becomes of his essence when he dies. If they fail in this, then the forces of nihilistic uncertainty manifest, and the warrior is stripped of his passion. This metaphysics need not be any great religious creed. One might simply lay down his life in defense of his family or homestead. Perhaps war will take him before he knows why he is engaging in it. And even in such a case, those that know him must be sure that his soul will transcend to the greater cause. Any good man would die in defense of the ones he loves, but few of us would die for the current rulers of the Western world. Where would be the honor in dying for a caste of people who despise you? The Western world itself had become ignorant of the spiritual problem up until it was thrown into the First World War. The excuse of the nation had replaced the spiritual absolutes and personal loyalties of the Middle Ages and the Renaissance. Of course, fighting simply in the name of a nation might sound adequate, but in reality, a nation provides no greater scope than itself, and the caste of liberal politicians that run them. It is honourable to die for one's homeland or people if one's love is sufficient, but a higher metaphysics is needed to prevent the onset of a vicious nihilism in such a case. It becomes increasingly difficult to die for one's homeland as the modern era draws on, and said homeland devolves into a form bereft of meaning, when it seems one would simply die for the right of one group of merchant leaders to continue to dominate another group of merchant leaders. When men died in their millions to industrial methods of death in the trenches, the West collectively found that it could not cope. Nobody could really answer why the men had died, or what for, or where they had gone to. Though it should be said that the war remained intensely popular among the populace of Europe whilst it was being fought. We falsely imagine this to be solely a problem of scale. All these new weapons that could kill in such vast numbers harrowed us, but this is quite false. I believe if a sufficient metaphysical fortitude exists among a cause, it can withstand any such shock of scale, as long as the will remains. How many computer-guided bombs and great mechanical horrors have rained down upon anti-Western groups in the Middle East? And yet, their morale never seems to waver, and the technological forces of the West would seem to be the ones in retreat. The reason why is that such fighters hold unshakable metaphysical absolutes, whereas the armies of the West hold nothing but vague sentiments of misplaced patriotism. When modern man looks upon those that would give their lives for a cause without doubt, he is simultaneously scornful and amused. He cannot imagine anything worth dying for better than his life of empty pleasures. Julius Evola, in his writings on war, places attention on the kamikaze or divine wind soldiers of the Second World War. And we will add to this the modern example of the anti-Western jihadist. Both the kamikaze and the jihadist are gravely misunderstood by the modern West that battles them, and by modern ideas in general. materialists place every emphasis on this life, and insist that after death we become nothing. They say there is no such thing as essence or soul. This is a radical and foolish notion that does nothing but cripple the fighting spirits of a people. When the kamikaze pilot took his plane into an enemy ship, he did so almost casually, without concern, because within such a metaphysical frame, one is merely giving up a preliminary stage of life, a physical being, for an eternal being. After such a death, one dwells among the realm of spirits and looks in upon the material world, knowing he exited it with honor. Likewise, when a Muslim dedicated to jihad detonates a suicide bomb, nothing could be further from his mind than suicide. The Quran prohibits such a thing, after all. He knows that by giving up a material existence in the name of an absolute and eternal truth, he is simply exchanging said material for said eternal. The problem that faces a modern would-be warrior, then, is that the old creeds of metaphysics have been stripped away or emasculated. Until he can place himself in such a frame, nihilism will be his companion. It is here that the desperate reactionary turns to Nietzsche. Nietzsche had sought for the means to overcome it and bring about a new type of individual that could forge new values and meaning. Since a return to the transcendent order of values was no longer possible, the overcoming of nihilism could only be achieved, he reasoned, by completing it and transforming a debilitating passive nihilism into an active nihilism that would lay the ground for a new flourishing of life. Another philosopher of the same problem, Ernst Jünger, wrote that there is no way out, neither sideways nor backwards. It is instead necessary to intensify the force and speed of the processes in which we are caught up. Jünger, like many, went to war in 1914 with an immense enthusiasm. But unlike others, Jünger's enthusiasm remained intact by the end of the war. He saw no senseless slaughter, but rather something that itself necessitated a higher purpose and a framework with which to understand it all. This was the chief philosophical task of the post-war years, and none other than Jünger truly rose to it. And yet, Jünger would never declare that machines made the creed of the warrior meaningless. He declared instead that the battle of the machines is so colossal that man almost completely disappears before it. Often already, caught in the force fields of the modern battlefield, it seemed to me strange and scarcely believable that I was witnessing world historical events. Combat took on the form of a gigantic, lifeless mechanism, and swept an icy, impersonal wave across the ground. It was like the cratered landscape of a dead star, lifeless and radiating heat. And yet behind all this is man. Only he gives the machines their direction and meaning. It is he that spits from their mouths bullets, explosives, and poison. He that elevates himself in them like birds of prey above the enemy. He that sits in their stomach as they stalk the battlefield, spewing fire. It is he, the most dangerous, bloodthirsty, and purposeful being that the earth has to carry. What men like Jünger saw in the hells of World War I was a kind of actualization, but more so than that, he realized that war could become its own metaphysical creed for he who knows how to fight it, and especially for he who knows how to die. Evola reached a similar conclusion when he proclaimed that to win or to lose a battle is really of no consequence to the warrior. All that matters to him is that he fights, and fights well. In a paragraph we perhaps all should learn by heart, Jünger concluded, "Death for a conviction is the highest accomplishment. It is proclamation, deed, fulfillment, faith, love, hope, and goal. It is, in this imperfect world, perfect thing. Absolute perfection. In this, the cause is nothing and the conviction everything. One can die stubbornly for an indubitable error. That is the greatest thing there is."